अमल हरि नाम अमि अभिलाष विपिन पुरंदर नवीन नगर वर यशोमति नंदन ब्रज बर नागर गोकुल रंजन काना ब्रज जन पालन सुरकुल नाशन नंद गोधन रखवाला गोविंद माधव नवनीत तस्कर सुंदर नंद गोपाल जमुना तटचर गोपी वसन हर रास रसिका कृपमोया श्री राधा वल्लभ वृंदावन नटवर श्री राधा वल्लभ वृंदावन नटवर भक्ति विनोदाश यशोमति नंदन ब्रज वर नागर यशोमति नंदन ब्रज वर नागर
जय श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय कृष्ण चंद्र भगवान की जय जन्माष्टमी महामहोत्सव की ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
Hare Krishna. We'll read from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3rd, Chapter 2, Text Number 12, and this chapter is entitled as Remembrance of Lord Krishna. Yan martalila yupaikam sayoga maya balam darshayata grahitam Vismapanam svisaya svisacha saubhagardihe param padam bhushana bhushanangam. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. The Lord appeared in the mortal world by His internal potency, Yoga Maya. He came in His eternal form, which is just suitable for His pastimes. These pastimes were wonderful for everyone, even for those proud of their own opulence, including the Lord Himself, in His forms as the Lord of Vaikuntha. Thus His, Sri Krishna's transcendental body is the ornament of all ornaments. Purport. In conformity with the Vedic hymns, Nityo Nityanam Chetanas Chetananam, the personality of Godhead is more excellent than all other living beings within all the universes in the material world. He is the chief of all living entities. No one can surpass Him or be equal to Him in wealth, strength, fame, beauty, knowledge or renunciation. When Lord Krishna was within this universe, He seemed to be a human being because He appeared in a manner just suitable for His pastimes in the mortal world. He did not appear in a human society in His Vaikuntha feature with four hands, because that would not have been suitable for His pastimes. But in spite of His appearing as a human being, no one was or is equal to Him in any respect in any of the six different opulences. Everyone is more or less proud of His opulence in the world, but when Lord Krishna was in human society, He excelled all His contemporaries within the universe. When the Lord's pastimes are visible to the human eye, they are called prakata. And when they are not visible, they are called aprakata. In fact, the Lord's pastimes never stop. Just as the sun never leaves the sky, the sun is always in its right orbit in the sky. But it is sometimes visible and sometimes invisible to our limited vision. Similarly, the pastimes of the Lord are always current in one universe or another. And when the Lord Krishna disappeared from the transcendental abode of Dwarka, it was simply a disappearance from the eyes of the people there. It should not be misunderstood that His transcendental body, which is just suitable for the pastimes in the material world, is in any way inferior to His different expansions in the Vaikuntha Loka. His body manifested in the material world is transcendental par excellence, in the sense that His pastimes in the mortal world excel His mercy displayed in the Vaikuntha Lokas. In the Vaikuntha Lokas, the Lord is merciful toward the liberated or Nitya Mukta living entities. But in His pastimes in the mortal world, He is merciful even to the fallen souls who are Nitya Baddha or conditioned forever. The six excellent opulence which He displayed in the mortal world by the agency of His internal potency, Yoga Maya, are rare even in the Vaikuntha Lokas. All His pastimes were manifested not by the material energy but by His spiritual energy. The excellence of His Rasalila at Vrindavan and His householder life with 16,000 wives, wonderful even for Narayan in Vaikuntha, and is certainly so for other living entities within the mortal world. His pastimes are wonderful even for other incarnations of the Lord, such as Sri Ram, Narsinga and Varaha. His opulence was so super excellent that His pastimes were adored even by the Lord of Vaikuntha, who is non-different from Lord Krishna Himself. Jai Shila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Om Ajnanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave. Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Juta Padakamalan Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Ragunatanvitam Tam Sachivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamscha Namom Vishnupadaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swamin Iti Namane Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisheshashunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarane Vancha Kalpataru Vishchakrapa Sindhubdevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Brishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priya. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. So we just heard from His Grace Gauranga Prabhu about the process of hearing as described by Parikshit Maharaj, and he explained very beautifully how Krishna is super excellent. And Prabhupada writes about that any hero in this material world cannot ever imagine to marry hundreds of women. And that is one of the most wonderful activities of the Lord. He gives the example of Ras Lila, and in his household life, he married more than 16,000 women. And he provided for everybody. And he provided a palace also, 16,000 palaces. So Krishna, as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, when he comes to this material world, along with his most powerful, exhibition of his Shakti, his energies. Last year we were discussing about Krishna's sweetness. How he becomes so human. Even though he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he becomes so human. He is willing to do everything what we all do. That is humility. In the material world, living entity wants to do what God does, while defying the existence of God. But here the Supreme Personality of God, and when He comes down to this material world, He does everything. Therefore, those who cannot understand, those who don't have the bhakti, they will ask this question, how can Krishna take birth? How can Krishna wind up His pastime like an ordinary living entity? How can Krishna steal butter? How can Krishna cry? How can Krishna eat mud? Because God and these things, they're very contradictory. They don't go well together. But Krishna does it. Why does it? Because as Uddhav, this is the remembrance of Uddhav about Krishna. Since today is Krishna's appearance day, it is better to follow in the footsteps of the great devotees of the Lord who had actually had love for Krishna. When Vidura, he was traveling around, when he came to meet with Uddhav, he asked about Krishna, Krishna's devotees, the Pandavas. And it is explained, the Bhagavatam explains, for some time Uddhav couldn't speak. He was stunned. He was crying tears without any movement. As if he had forgotten Krishna, apparently it appeared, but he had not forgotten Krishna. He was always remembering Krishna, and someone who was similar like Uddhav reminded him of Krishna, then he went into ecstasy. Like recently I was with Gaur Krishna Prabhu's family, and as Gaurampu was mentioning that, whenever today in the morning as we were doing some seva in the altar, I remember every year Murli Prabhu, Gaur Krishna Prabhu, Gagan, they would come with a dress. Almost at the last moment, creating more excitement. You would not even know what kind of dress you are going to give to the Lord. And they would direct the entire decoration, the entire outfit, how to put the outfit, what kind of turban, what kind of waist cloth. They would not dress, but they would direct. Whole night, staying up. And then after seeing the dress, after the darshan is over, they would go back to their own home and try to worship the Lord full day. His mother, Murli Mohan Prabhu's mother, came on this Sunday. And whenever she meets devotees, after a few days, she has to cry. She came to invite devotees that all of you should come for Janmastami festival. I try to please Madan Mohanji as much as my son was able to please, and she started crying. And Gaur Krishna Prabhu's father and his sister-in-law, they were saying that whenever we worship the Lord, we always remember. The father said, Prabhuji, I can't forget. So his knees, Gaur Krishna Prabhu's knees, she would tell them, why you want to forget him? So there is no need to forget. Why you want to forget him? You can talk to him. She shows the picture. You should not forget him. Just like you talk to Krishna, you can talk to him. Why you want to forget? We are worried that I want to forget the bad experience. But here is as small as this baby girl. She is saying, why you want to forget? Don't forget. If you talk to him, then he will talk to you. He will respond to you. So similarly here, Krishna, Uddhav, you know, he is so fortunate, but because of his good fortune, he is making himself so unfortunate. He said, I took Krishna so lightly. We Yadavas are so unfortunate. In fact, Janmastami festival, it is not only occasion of celebration. It is not only the occasion of, you know, experiencing joy. That people do in mundane festival also. In marriage, people are dancing, jumping. There is no sobriety. In holy festival, there is no sobriety. And today, you'll see all around Mumbai, people are breaking pots. But that doesn't mean that they're coward boys. No. No. They are breaking for something else. So Janmastami is also the festival of increasing sobriety. I think therefore we fast. It naturally enhances our sobriety. As the day passes, it becomes evening, we become more and more sober. Why sobriety? Because Uddhav is thinking, how much I took Krishna lightly. In fact, Srila Prabhupada explains our whole process is not about I have Krishna. I don't have Krishna. It's a beautiful chapter, Remembrance of Uddhav. You know, I recommend all the devotees today, if you want to actually enhance your appreciation for Krishna, one should understand how Uddhav and Arjuna appreciated. Both of them. When Arjuna came back from Hastinapura, Dwarka, and when Vidur met Uddhav, what are they talking about? They are talking about that we took Krishna very lightly. We are so unfortunate. Arjuna says the same thing. He says, my dear brother, that Krishna was so kind to me that he allowed me to sleep on the same bed. He allowed me to stroll. He allowed me to eat with him. And sometime, as a joke, I would say, Krishna, you are very truthful, huh? He would say, Arjuna would conclude that Krishna is speaking lie, but I had the audacity to say, Krishna, you are speaking truthful. And all these words, all these joking words, all this free talk with him, my Lord did not take it as an offense. Just like a mother or a father forgives son, or the friend forgives his friend. Similarly, my Lord was willing to take all kinds of casual gestures with me. No, very, very interesting. So therefore, Janmastami, Krishna's appearance, we have to evolve with many emotions. It is not only about celebrating, you know, throwing colors, throwing flowers, enjoying feast. That is also part of celebrating Janmastami, but more than anything else, becoming sober, that how I am wasting my life, even though Krishna came to this material world. If Uddhav and Arjun can feel like this, if the gopis can feel like this, if Nanda Maharaj and Yashoda can feel like this, they never felt that, you know, Krishna is always with us. In fact, they felt we are so unfortunate that Krishna is not there with us. We did not treat him very nicely. So therefore, it's a very sobering activity also. It's a day to express our gratitude. It is the day to express our regret. It is the day to express our determination. Therefore, we see Arjuna, when Krishna went back to the spiritual world, he felt almost he forgot the entire conversation he had with Krishna on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. But by constant remembrance of the Lord, which was caused by Yudhishthira Maharaj, he felt all that which he had heard on the battlefield or on the other occasions came back to him, and all the trash which was there in the heart. How can there be trash in the heart of a devotee? How can there be trash in the heart of a pure devotee? But when we are not in conclusion with scripture, when we are not in, you know, in Krishna consciousness, that is a trash. And that's what Arjuna was remembering. And because he remembered that, immediately Krishna came back to his heart. All the trash disappeared. That's what Srimad Bhagavatam explains. Therefore, very, very interesting chapter. So when Krishna appeared in this material world, Prabhupada explains very beautifully, when the Lord stays in the spiritual world, he is only available to the pure devotees, the Nitya Siddhas. He is not there for the conditioned souls. Conditioned souls don't have access to Krishna. Therefore, we see in the Western world, in the Western concept of religion, they don't celebrate the God's appearance. The modern human beings, they spend millions of rupees to celebrate their own birthdays. But when the concept of God's appearance comes, they say, oh God, why should we celebrate God's birthday? Because God does not come to this material world. You walk around all over Bombay streets, you only see big billboards of, you know, hooligan politicians. They're looting the country. Actually, that is my subject today. Krishna's governance. You know, how Krishna allowed the proper governance, because that is the purpose he came to this material world. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkrutam. So all these politicians putting their posters about their birthday, spending, you know, spoiling the ecosystem and spending money on wine and meat. And what, anyone will get any kinds of benefit? But when it comes to Krishna's appearance, they make an objection. Why should we? But the Vedic system is that Krishna's appearance, he does not take birth in this world, because birth is one of the four miseries. Janma, Mrtu, Jara, Vyadhi. Being misery, why should God come to this material world? He should not. We come to this material world forced by our own karma. We carry the burden of our karma like an ass. You know, moving about, you know, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. But Krishna does not come for that. His coming to this material world is nothing but his extreme degree of kindness. He comes and he gives himself to everybody. Whether through his pastime or his Paramatma feature also. One devotee said, what is this Paramatma feature? Paramatma feature, it may sound that, you know, why is he there sitting as a monitor, as a police officer? No, it is not like that. It is also like that, but more than that, Krishna is giving charity of himself to all the living entities. I will stay with you forever, whichever species you go. Whether human being or a cockroach, the Paramatma is there. And wherever the cockroach goes, wherever the human being goes, the Paramatma never says that I can't come here. He is always there with all the living entities, willing to give. So therefore Krishna, his appearance to this material world is his kindness. He comes and performs his pastime, and therefore all our scriptures are so precise about Krishna's coming to this material world that, and I'll just, I can't remember this one, but I can read. The Lord came in Dwapar Yuga. Just see the preciseness of his birth. You can calculate it. It is calculated as, he came in the conclusion of Dwapar Yuga, when Dwapar Yuga was, you know, is consisting of 864,000 years. So Krishna came 8,63,000 years and 20 months and 4 days. That preciseness you have. Through Panchang you can calculate like that. Why like that? So that we can celebrate Krishna's appearance properly. In the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Rupa Goswami says, he quotes one devotee praying to Krishna, "My dear Lord, please tell me when is your birthday so that we can celebrate properly." So when Krishna comes, as I said, we express our gratitude. So this very Krishna who performs most wonderful pastime, we see if you study Krishna's character when he came here and stayed for 125 years. And he stayed only 10 years in Vrindavan, 10 to 11 years in Vrindavan. And performed most amazing pastimes. In fact, even though Krishna did continue to perform his pastime out of Vrindavan also, but everyone is madly attracted to Vrindavan pastimes. Even someone like Lilashuk, Bilvamangal Thakur, he was a monist. He was actually a follower of Shakta, Shaiva. And in one verse he explains that I would not give up this Panchakshari mantra, Om Namah Shivaya. But this son of Nanda Maharaj, he has maddened my heart. I don't know what's happening with me. Another great monist, Madhusudan Saraswati also, Mukunda Saraswati. Same thing. You know, you discuss with them philosophy, they will try to establish Shankaracharya, but when you start speaking Bhagavatam, they become speechless. This is what Lilashuk also says. Why? Because Krishna's activities, his childhood pastimes are so fascinating that if you know he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which it is not that the Brajbasi did not know Krishna is the Supreme Lord, but Krishna's pastimes are so fascinating that their knowledge would continuously get covered over again and again. And that combination that you know Krishna is the Supreme Lord, at the same time he covers you through yoga maya potency, that is the beauty of Krishna Lila. He also covers people like Shishupal. They also hear Krishna's pastime. But they take it them to be ordinary because there is an inherent envy. Shishupal also heard about Krishna's pastime in Vrindavan, but he would not take it seriously. Why? Because there was inherent envy. But the Yashoda and Nanda Maharaj and other gopis, they took this pastime very seriously, you know, but at the same time, this combination of going back and forth, like Mother Yashoda seeing Krishna's mouth, and in that mouth she saw the mud, she saw the soil, at the same time seeing the entire cosmic manifestation. This combined thing, you see the soil and feel concerned, and you see the universal form and get bewildered. Very interesting this combination. Therefore Lord Chaitanya also explains another aspect that Krishna's pastimes, their combination of poison and nectar. How can you drink poison and nectar simultaneously? Not possible. Either you drink poison and die, and drink nectar and become immortal. But they are combined. They are combined like this. Nectar is there and poison is there. Bewilderment is there. At the same time, entertainment is also there. Like one devotee, he explains one such story of Krishna. One day Krishna was asking Mother Yashoda. He said, "My dear mother, where does the cows go every day?" Mother said, "They go for grazing." Krishna said, "What do you mean by grazing?" He said, "Grazing means they go into the forest and they chew on the most refreshing grass." So then Krishna asked the next question. He said, "Why do they eat grass?" Then Yashoda said, "Because they eat grass so that they can give nice milk." Then Krishna's next question, "But my dear mother, grass is green, milk is white. Why does it happen like that?" So this time Mother Yashoda said, "My dear Krishna, that is inconceivable. That is the potency of the Lord." Then Krishna asked the next question, "What do you mean by inconceivable potency of the Lord?" Mother Yashoda said, "I don't understand.
I am also like that cow only. Then Krishna said, I know why your milk is also white. She is like cow, that means her milk also has to be white only. So another time Krishna was lying and Krishna's mother was chanting, you know, she was singing just to make Krishna go to sleep. And she was glorifying Churabdakshai Vishnu. Then Krishna asked her, what are you doing? She said, I am singing song for Lord Vishnu. He said, who is that? She said, oh, he sleeps on the Kshir Sagar. He's the Shesha Shai. He's sleeping. Krishna said, if he's sleeping, what is the point in singing? So then Yashoda, when Krishna said that to Mother Yashoda, I am singing those songs to him so that you can sleep. So that you can also sleep, he can also sleep. So in this way, Krishna would create such an amazing pastime. Another time he went to one gopi. And this gopi came down and she saw Krishna was putting his hand in the clay pot, taking out the butter. So she called, who is that? Krishna said, it is the brother of Balram. He said, what are you doing? What are you doing here? So Krishna said, I'm in my home. No, he said, whose home is this? So she said, it's my home. That gopi came down. Oh, Krishna said, I thought it's my home. So then she said, what are you doing? She said, I'm looking for my calf. She said, why in the clay pot? Because I searched everywhere. I didn't find, so better I should look here also. Then the gopi asked, okay, did you find? He said, I'm looking. So if you did not find, what are you doing with the butter? He said, I'm going deeper to find if calf is there or not. But where is the butter? She asked. He said, the butter I can't keep down. You dull-headed gopi. He said, I can't keep the butter down. So since there is no place to keep the butter down, I said, the best place to keep the butter is in my mouth. So in this way, Krishna... Now, if you read the Bhagavatam 10th canto, the childhood pastimes of Krishna are so innocent. They're so innocent. So anyone, you know, even the ordinary child when acts idiotly, as long as he doesn't go to school. As long as the child doesn't go to school, his idiotic activities are taken very seriously. Means people enjoy. But once he goes to school, and if he acts innocently, then he gets all kind of branding, dull-headed, needs extra tuition, has to be taken to psychiatrist also, for being this child, that child. Right. So Krishna, when he performs activities which are very illogical, materially illogical, then what happens? All the gopis, the Brajabasis, Nanda Maharaj, Yashoda, the gopis, everyone becomes very fascinated. He cannot hold the shoes also. He is trying to hold the shoes of Nanda Maharaj to bring. He cannot hold grains also. When he came to barter with that lady who came to sell, you know, fruits, Krishna ran inside. He saw what they are doing. They are not giving money. They are bartering. They are giving grain. They are giving clothes. In exchange, they are getting fruits. So Krishna also wanted to imitate. He went inside. He didn't want to wear clothes also. He goes inside and gets some grains. When he comes out, almost there is nothing in his hand. He can't even hold grains. And this gopi, this Pulinda woman, when she saw this, that Krishna is doing like this, she's so fascinated. She just pours everything, all that fruits, and gives it to Krishna. There is no logic in her barter system. Because Krishna did not give her anything, but she's not only giving all the fruits at big loss. So, as we read in the Shastra, that devotional service, philosophically we read, apratihata ahituki, there should not be any motivation, there should not be any interruption in bhakti. We have to repeatedly hear. But the problem is when we come to Krishna, if we know that He is God, what do? We come and ask. We are forced to ask. Krishna, please help me here. Krishna, help me there. But here the Brajabasis don't need to discuss the philosophy. They are without any problem, without any hesitation, without any hindrance. They just give their heart to Krishna so much, and they know by giving heart to Krishna means you have to lose your heart. Like Mother Devaki, Yashoda, Nanda Maharaj. In fact, they prayed to Krishna that, my Lord, you should become our son. And Krishna became their son. But it is explained when Yashoda, when Vasudeva brought the baby to Nanda Maharaj's place, what he performed tapasya to get the son. Vasudeva and Devaki performed tapasya so that they can have the son. But what they had to do? They gave the son to the whole world. That was their charity. That was their sacrifice. That they gave their son to the entire world. He is not meant for us. Our benefit is what? Our benefit is that we perform the tapasya. That is bhakti. That you work hard and somebody else enjoys. And they are doing it not consciously. They are doing it as if it is their life. That is their breathing. And then Yashoda grew Krishna, Nanda Maharaj, they know Krishna was growing with them, and suddenly at the age of 11 age, if you see, the child in one sense does not create much anxiety. Nowadays 11 what? 7 is a problem. So 11 age is still very innocent, very clean, you know, still submissive to the parents. Still the child feels, I need my parents. No, if you ask any 11-10-year-old kids, you know, why don't you go to the best of the school, which is away from your parents? They said, no, we want our parents to be with us. So that was the time when the attachment was at its peak. Krishna moved out of Vrindavan. Why was he going out of Vrindavan? Naturally to prove that bhakti is about that you cannot have Krishna all the time with you. On a physical platform. What happens? Krishna goes away. And he wants to give it to others. He wants to give himself to others. Only 11 years in Vrindavan. Right. So therefore we see that to have Krishna in our life and to understand the philosophy of Krishna consciousness and to apply this Krishna consciousness concept, as Gaurampa was mentioning, philosophy is very easy, but application is the most difficult. Because what application involves? Application involves less benefits, more sacrifice. Bhakti is all about less benefit for oneself from a personal point of view, but more benefit for others. That is bhakti. Gopis did not get any benefit, only 11 years, and Krishna never ever came back. They did not file an abuse case in the court. You know, this child abused us. The gopis did not abuse Krishna. Why? Because that's a life. In fact, they would say that it is so regrettable that we are still surviving when Krishna met with the gopis in Kurukshetra. What did the gopis say? They say, my dear Lord, we are so unfortunate. That even in your operation, in your separation, we are still holding our life. That shows that we don't have love. Krishna said, no, you have love, you are crying. Then Radharani said, that is all fake. Those tears are what? Those tears are not true tears. In fact, if I was actually loving you, in your separation, I should have died. The mere fact is that I am still living, that shows that there is no love. Now this is the super excellent quality of a devotee. He beats Krishna also. How does he beat Krishna? He beats Krishna by saying that I have no love for you. If anybody says I have love for Krishna, how can anybody say he has love for Krishna? Only a fool will say. A devotee will not say. In fact, a devotee will say, I am not a devotee. Anybody says I am a devotee, anybody says in Kali Yuga that I am a human being, that itself is a, you know, that's itself is a questionable. to say that I'm a human being. Human beings have some discipline. In fact, animals also have a discipline. They know when to mate. They know when to procreate, when they know when to eat. They know when to sleep. You know, if you see the life of an animal, a bird, their life is so regulated. Only when they come in touch with, you know, modern cities, even the animals change. But if you see the modern human being's life, can you call it a life? What time they sleep? When they are supposed to sleep, they are studying. When they are supposed to sleep, they are working. When they are supposed to sleep, they are doing party, and some police stops it. They want, you are going against our freedom. If you see the life of a human being in Kali Yuga, you can't call a human being. We are not living like human beings. Our habits, our eating habits, our sleeping habits, our relationship, everything is not even animalistic. Not even animalistic. Actually, if you analyze, a Kali Yuga human being, you know, his attire, his speech, his eating habits, his food habits, what he calls as decoration, what he calls as makeup, being naked is considered as gorgeous. Because of that whole World War took place. Now not allowing nakedness, wars are taking place. Just imagine. So we are not even human beings. What to speak of such non-subhuman being who is not acting as human being by some grace, comes to Krishna consciousness and calls, I am in Madhuryalas. My sampradaya is in Madhuryalas. Can you imagine? How can we claim ourselves as a devotee when we are not even proper human beings? Therefore our Dharampa was mentioning, you know, we should not think ourselves as the gift to the material world. We are burdened to the material world. You know, with a wrong understanding of Krishna consciousness, wrong application of Krishna consciousness, when you walk around to this world, you know, people become scared. You know, stay away from these people because they are not reasonable. But the real devotee of the Lord, like Vidur, Uddhav, Arjun, Yudhishthira Maharaj, we were discussing 2 days back, Yudhishthira Maharaj, what a personality he is. You know, from the very beginning he didn't want to be the king. During the war he didn't want to be the king. When the war was over, when there was no one, there was no competition for him, Bhima never told Krishna, Krishna, I think I should be made the king. Arjuna never came to Krishna, Krishna, you said in the Bhagavad Gita, I am the most dear to you, I should be made the king. Nakul Sahadev never came. Satyaki never came. Nobody even thought in their mind that I should be king. What to speak of even speaking? You know, sometimes we send signals, vibrations. Right. We may not speak because we are a little worried about what people say. But we send signals, strong signals. O bimar pad jana tha taki mujhe seva mil jayega. Usko ye hona chahiye. And we again regret, no, I should not say like this. But we send these strong vibrations. But they didn't send any vibrations like that. You know, Krishna wanted Yudhishthira Maharaj to be the king. Then what Yudhishthira Maharaj says? He says, this is nothing but my own selfish desire to be the king. He said, this war is okay if it was meant for administration. If it was meant for proper governance. But this war was not meant for that. This war was meant for my own self-aggrandizement. He said, I don't fit into this war, which is a dharma yuddha. You know, I made so many women become widows. He says, I cannot clean. When Vyasadeva told him, you perform Ashwamedha sacrifice, what does Yudhishthira say? He said, I killed human beings, now you are asking me to kill animal. He said, a liquor pot cannot be cleaned with liquor. A muddy pot cannot be cleaned with mud. So similarly, one yajna cannot be cleaned with another yajna. All blame goes to me. This is Yudhishthira Maharaj. Not willing to take any justification. Not willing to say, you know, I am justified to fight this war because I am a Kshatriya. First, greater than that, I am doing on behalf of Krishna. If you don't believe me, ask Krishna only. He told us, nothing he takes like that. So that is devotee. And therefore they are there in the Bhagavatam. They are in the scriptures. So when we understand that Krishna's appearance has to make us very sober. At least that's what the reflection came to me yesterday night. You know, when I was reading the Bhagavatam, third canto, reading the story of Uddhava, suddenly the whole understanding changed. My God, Krishna's appearance is not about, you know, jumping from the morning only. It is becoming more and more sober. And then I realized, otherwise always this question was there, why on the occasion of appearance, why somebody is forced to fast? Whole day fasting. Why? Like, Radhananda Maharaj explains, he asked somebody, now the Ramadan is also going on. When he was in Iran, he asked somebody, why do we fast? So they said, fasting is to express our concern, to experience what others are going through. Those who don't get any food, they don't get any water to drink, they don't know where they'll get their next meal also. So by consciously remaining hungry throughout the day, then you realize those people who are suffering, you know, almost every day for the rest of their life. So similarly, you know, when we fast, that makes us sober, makes us reflect on why Krishna came to this material world. Why should he come? But he came. He came to give mercy to us also, as Prabhupada mentions. He gives mercy to the pure devotees as a very hope-giving purport. We don't fall into the category of human beings also. We are not devotees also. But still Krishna comes to this material world and performs his pastimes and gives us the Srimad Bhagavatam, and through that we can actually remember Krishna and become attracted by Krishna's beautiful pastime and get purified. And therefore Krishna performs this pastime. Very enlightening, very entertaining pastimes. Therefore Krishna's appearance, when Krishna appeared, very interesting. When a demon appears and when Krishna appears, it's very big difference. In the third canto of the Bhagavatam, there is the appearance of Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha. And if you read the pastime of their appearance, Sukadeva Goswami explains to Parikshit Maharaj that when Kashyap and Diti, when they conceived in the wrong time because of the sense gratification, now the timing was not very good. And Kashyapa was warning Diti that this is not the right time to conceive because Lord Shiva is moving about, you know, going along with his hobgoblins, ghosts and pishachis. And when someone engages in this kind of activities at the wrong time, what does he do? He places such ghosts, hobgoblins and pishachis, those who don't have material body, he places such souls in the embryo of such a woman. Prabhupada writes that purport. And he also explains, very harsh. Actually, Vedanta is very harsh. And therefore, people sometimes say, you know, karma, why do you talk about karma? There is no such as Vedanta is sweet. Vedanta is truthful. So Prabhupada writes that and he says, whenever you see some kind of natural catastrophe, you should realize some big demon is being born. He writes in the Bhagavatam purport. Somewhere, we don't know where. Recently in Badrinath, near Badrinath, you know, clouds, they burst. Just imagine cloud bursting. When there is a heavy rain, it causes so much of disaster. When the cloud bursts, cloud bursting means if you have a water tank up on your home, you know, 1 lakh liter and your home is 400 square feet. And if the tank bursts, imagine what will happen. The entire water gushing into your home, you can't do anything. You can't save anything. You have to run out of the home. So many natural catastrophe, it's happening. And if you study, when a demon is born, when Duryodhana was born, how was he born? What kind of birth he had? From very beginning, when Yudhishthira was born, it was very auspicious. And hearing the birth of Yudhishthira Maharaj, Gandhari became impatient. Certainly she was envious, but we don't see envy, but we can see impatience. Right. When she was less than 9 months, she realized that my son is not older to Kunti's son. And that made her so much of impatience, she struck her belly with her fist. And lump of flesh came out. What was that lump of flesh? That lump of flesh was nothing but, you know, the complete impatience, envy of Pandavas, of Kunti. And then she called upon Vyasadeva. Vyasadeva by not, it was not divine. It was some kind of magic. Otherwise, a touch of Vyasadeva should have created 100 better Pandava children. No, 100 children came out from this envious, you know, consciousness of Gandhari, and these 100 children had continuous envy towards Pandavas. And when Duryodhana was born, Vidura told us what was happening. You know, peacocks, there was no light shower, you know, the Shravan month were not producing the flowers of Vasanta season. In fact, the jackals, the vultures, ass, and all kinds of inauspicious living entities were braying, shouting, screaming when Duryodhana was born. Same thing happened when Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha was born. Same thing happened when Kamsa was also born. Kamsa's birth itself is so inauspicious because he was not a legitimate child of his parents. He was an illegitimate child. So therefore we see that when the demons are born, they come to create inauspiciousness, they come to create trouble, and when Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha, they started growing, they were all like the Olympic players, you know. They're like hefty, steel framed, you know, our children give me the report, Prabhuji, kuch nahi mila gold. No, how will you get gold? Because you have to make body like that. Right? Eating all kinds of things. You have to drink human blood. Cow's flesh. Like Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha. Sitting on the throne, Hiranyakashipu Prabhupada writes, he would not only drink wine, he would drink blood. You know, he would sit on the asana, he would drink the blood of cow, and he would drink the blood of human beings also. That's what Ravan says to Mother Sita. Just his love. You know, Ravan, you know, nowadays one-sided love means they only put acid. Gruesome, horrible. But Ravan's one-sided love was, he said, if you don't love me, if you don't marry me, you'll become my breakfast in the morning time. Can you imagine? Ravan is saying this to Mother Sita, I will eat you up. You know, such a horrible creature. Has to be killed by Ram. Right. So therefore, since demonic forces, when becomes too prominent, and therefore Sukadeva Goswami begins the Bhagavatam, in fact narrating the pastimes of Krishna, first he congratulates Parikshit Maharaj, and after congratulating Parikshit Maharaj, what does he say? When the demonic forces became too prominent on the Bhumi, and all these demonic forces were going as Kshatriyas, and Mother Bhumi being overburdened by them, she approached Brahmaji, you know, disguised herself as cow. That is the beginning. So therefore Krishna had to come. When all the demigods along with Brahmaji went to the Lord said, I already know the trouble. So we don't have to worry, you know, sometimes we feel that unless we approach Krishna, Krishna will not relieve our material burden. No, that is not a problem. Krishna already knows. He said, I know, I've already decided to come. And when Krishna came to this material world, when he went out of Vrindavan to establish dharma, to establish proper governance, and if you study Mahabharata carefully, how many demons he had to deal with? First of all the demons who were connected to Kamsa, they came to Mathura only in Vrindavan. Krishna had, he has not planned to start proper governance. You know, Putana came, Trinavarta came, Shakatashur came, Kaliya came, Dhenuka came, Aghasur came, Bakasur came, Keshi came, so many demons came. They were all sent by Kamsa. And in fact, these demons had no proper plan about, you know, helping Kamsa to rule. You know, they were demons. They were higher demons basically. And Krishna killed all of them when he came to Mathura. He killed Kamsa, his very uncle. We see in Krishna Lila, Krishna did not make any partiality between my family or somebody else's family. Shishupal was also equally related to Krishna as much as Yudhishthira Maharaj was related. Same relationship. Shishupal's mother and Yudhishthira's mother were sisters. So there was no such discrimination. He had a fair treatment. If you act demonically, I will kill you. If you act nicely, whether you are from my family or not from my family, you know, I will give mercy. Narakasur was his very son, in fact, came from Varaha Avatar. He took Satyabhama along with him and killed Narakasur in front of Satyabhama only. So when Krishna killed Kamsa, after killing Kamsa, very soon Krishna sent a messenger to Hastinapur through Akrur to Dhritarashtra, and today morning Prabhupada was speaking about it. He said when he sent a message to Akrur, Dhritarashtra, he in fact warned Dhritarashtra basically indirectly, look, be careful, if you do not treat Pandavas properly, your situation will be like Kamsa only. And what does Dhritarashtra say? And Prabhupada talks about it. Dhritarashtra says, you know, everything is moving by the will of God. What can I do? I cannot do anything about it. Whatever has to happen will happen. This is what blaming God, you know, acting as if, you know, I only depend on God. Everything is happening by the will of the Lord, but not taking responsibility. Dhritarashtra was not willing to take the responsibility. And what Krishna did? From there, Krishna's movement, you know, is moving from one place to another place. He was hardly in Dwarka. Lord Ram, he banished his own people staying in his kingdom because he was a king. Krishna did not become the king, one devotee was saying. One devotee says in his one poem, he said when Surabhi cow came to do Abhishek to Krishna, no, Krishna said, I am not the king. Only kings are performed Abhishek. So Surabhi wanted to establish Krishna as the king of the entire world. Krishna said, I don't want to be the king because I got troubled when I became the king in Ayodhya. When I had to banish my own wife, I have to banish my own brother. You know, because of me, my father had to suffer. So in this lila, I have decided not to take any post. I will not take any post in this world. Why? Because if you take post, then you become responsible. By not taking post, I want to fulfill my responsibility. Just see, Krishna never took any post. Sometimes people say, unless you have a post, you cannot function properly. And Krishna is throwing no post. When Ugrasen Maharaj, after killing Kamsa, Krishna made Ugrasen the king. And Uddhava remembers that Krishna would stand in front of Ugrasen and he would ask, my dear Lord, you know, this is the report I want to offer you. Please hear. And watch, what service should I do for you? And Uddhava says, when I hear this statement, my dear Vidur, my heart pains that our Lord standing and is asking and giving reports to Ugrasen Maharaj. When Yudhishthira Maharaj was sending Krishna to Jarasan, Yudhishthira Maharaj did not send. Krishna gave the plan. You know, only three of us we will go and capture Jarasan. We will fight him before the Rajasuya sacrifice. And Yudhishthira Maharaj said, what will you do with him? He said, I will go and beg. When Yudhishthira Maharaj heard that Krishna is going to beg on my behalf, he had tears in his eyes. That Lord is going there. He is not even having a war with Jarasan. He wanted to play a different strategy. I will go and ask Yuddha Bhiksha. But Bhiksha is Bhiksha only. To take the position of a beggar, it's not an ordinary thing. Nowadays, you know, asking money, charity, that itself is a big profession only. In the Western world, and in the Christian world, you know, there are big, big seminars how to raise funds for church. And most qualified people are hired for raising funds. Right, but here Krishna is a very unorganized, you go beggar, cannot decide. Okay, I go to this home, every day I will go. We were discussing 2 days back. No, brahmacharya life means what? Begging. But nowadays, if you become a little senior, a little old, you sit in your own room and the prasad comes to you. So we are not living actual ideal beggar's life. Beggar's life means every day, you know, you go out and beg. When Krishna stayed in the Gurukul, he went and begged. Not that the prasad came to him, because he was acting as a student. So that is a beggar's profession, that he has to go and beg. And Krishna was willing to go and beg. And what was he begging? Yuddha Bhiksha. And he begged it from Jarasan. Right. So Krishna went around begging. You know, whether it is Yuddha Bhiksha he was begging, or when Rajasuya sacrifice took place, what Krishna did? You know, he was serving, he was washing the feet of the sages. And he was serving prasad. Not even serving prasad. Shripad Madhvacharya explained that he was, when all the sages would eat prasad, Krishna's seva was to lift all the leftover plates. Krishna took that service. He was willing to take that service. And if you study Mahabharata, how much the Lord struggled to establish Dharmaraj. It was not an easy task. We were discussing recently, it took 84 years to establish Yudhishthira Maharaj as the king. The Supreme Personality of God, it took 84 years. You know, what can Anna Hazare and Ramdev do? What can they do? With Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, having proper people like Yudhishthira Maharaj, it took 84 years. He didn't say, okay, tomorrow we'll establish the kingdom. How much struggle? He got Yudhishthira Maharaj to perform Rajasuya sacrifice, establishes Yudhishthira Maharaj as the emperor, and he goes to Dwarka, and Yudhishthira Maharaj loses everything in the gambling match. Fakir, in one day, he lost everything. Back to the forest. Having nothing at their disposal, nothing to eat also, there is no water also. They're walking in the forest. When Krishna comes back to meet them in the Kampilya, I think, yeah, in the Kampilya, when he came to meet them, what does the Lord say? He said, at least I should have known about this, I would have stopped it. So you see, sometime the Lord acting as a human being experiences failure also. In bhakti, it is not that once we become devotee of Krishna, then everything is a royal road. Prabhupada did not experience that. Giriraj Maharaj would mention in one lecture that as a devotee of the Lord, one, unfortunately the problem with a Kanishtha devotee is that he wants to experience miracle and prove that I am a very special devotee. That we want to share our stories of miracles also. Mere saath mein aisa ho gaya. Arjun ke saath bhi hua tha aur baad mein mere saath mein aisa ho. You know, we want to act as if we also have some stories to share which are very, very, you know, mystical in nature. But in bhakti, if you want to actually experience bhakti, all mysticism has to be taken out. What has to be experienced is real human. With the Pandavas, with the Gopis, they had to experience the real feeling of Krishna's separation. Even though Krishna was there, the Pandavas had to experience, you know, the separation, the gruesome death of their son. Abhimanyu was killed on the battlefield. All the 5 sons of Draupadi were killed on the battlefield. Draupadi's father was killed on the battlefield. Draupadi's 2 brothers were killed on the battlefield. You know, Subhadra's, see, the sister of Krishna, Arjuna's wife, her son was killed on the battlefield. Uttara's son, Parikshit, was killed. His body, you know, whether the Bhagavatam version or Mahabharata version, the Mahabharata version says that the body came out blue and black. It was almost like, you know, when you burn a tire, that kind of lump was there, lying. So what do you see in the story of Krishna? There is so much of human activities, and even in that condition the Pandavas continue to worship Krishna. That is bhakti. Bhakti is not about experiencing mystical thing. When I was standing in front of the deities, suddenly the flower came down. Flower came down because the pujari did not stuck it properly. And when you were there, the flower fell down. That's all. There is no mystical thing in this. So therefore, Krishna took 84 years of hard work to establish proper governance. And in the middle, so many failures. Yudhishthira Maharaj gambles everything, you know, and he walks out of the forest and Krishna comes there and again reorganizes everything. You know, killing Jarasan. Not that he wanted to kill Jarasan because, you know, he had some personal agenda. Because Jarasan had a personal agenda. Bhagavatam explains that Kamsa was performing all these cruel activities supported by Jarasan. Why? Because Jarasan wanted to be the emperor. Everybody had their own agenda. In the Mahabharata, sometimes people ask this question, why those who are on the Pandava side also got killed? No, not all the people who are working on the Pandava side were devotees. They also had their agenda. No, they had their personal agenda, and there were devotees on the other side also. You know, they had their brain was bewildered, at least for some time. Dronacharya, Bhishmadeva, Bhurishrava, they're fighting on behalf of Duryodhan against Krishna. Can you imagine? They were perfect chanters. They would never miss their morning program even on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. It writes, the Mahabharata explains, every day in the morning all the warriors, they would perform their sandhya without fail. Never missed it. As Gauranga Prabhu mentioned that Harishwar Prabhu gave 7 stories, I became a little scared that people start, you know, and not telling the story will give them greater chance to speculate. Maybe my situation is the best situation not to chant 16 round. But here the warriors, in fact there is another story also. Prabhupada told one devotee, you know, he was not able to, he had no time to do anything. He said, Prabhupada, I have got so much of service, I am not able to chant Hare Krishna. He said, how many hours you sleep? He said, sleep 2 hours. Minimize your sleeping, but don't minimize your seva, but continue chanting 16 rounds. There are balancing stories also. You know, not only this kind of stories. So, at Kurukshetra, all these warriors, you know, they were performing their sadhana without fail. They would not go to the battlefield without performing their sadhana. So all these people, you know, such a complex situation on the battlefield, and what happened? Krishna had to do many things, many, many things to establish Yudhishthir as the king. And after establishing Yudhishthir Maharaj the king, Krishna goes back to Dwarka. You know, he's not staying there remote control. Somebody else controls and somebody else is the prime minister, you know. He didn't do like that. Somebody, our dharmic, you know, I think we should know this. Therefore, you know, we are talking about governance. Dharmi gave me he said, when we were going for Tuesday program, when there was a power grid, like for many hours, there was no power in North India. Then it's a joke. It's not the Prime Minister addressed. So he said that, my dear citizens, you understand what one has to go through when there is no power. You suffered 8 years of no power. I am suffering 8 hours of no power. I am suffering 8 years of no power. So just imagine, Krishna was never remote control. He wanted to establish Yudhishthira Maharaj as the king. And he established and he is going out. That's why Kunti comes and she says, my dear Lord, now you are going out. It is not good for us. We have got prosperity. That means because they were fearful of prosperity, only they were qualified to be the king. In fact, the Shastra explains that the entire property of Mother Bhumi, of course controlled by Krishna, but in the mundane world, that property belongs to the Brahmanas. Now, what kind of Brahmanas? You know, the true Brahmanas, those who are actually Brahmanas, who are kind, compassionate, living simply, you know, living austere life, their life is meant for others, such Brahmanas own everything. And those who claim proprietorship, it belongs to me, it belongs to me, it belongs to me, they are not qualified to rule. only those who say it does not belong to me. Yudhishthira Maharaj is like that. He never claimed any proprietorship. And when Krishna went back to the spiritual world, what happened? He could have continued ruling. He had life. He was strong. He was able to walk to Himalayan mountains. That means he was able to sit on the throne also. He was not so invalid. But once Krishna went back to the spiritual world, can you imagine the detachment? No, being the king of the entire world and with the powerful support of Arjuna, Bhima, Nakul, Sahadev and all of the warriors, he's just walking out. And here, even as a devotee, you know, we may talk about renouncing. You know, I think I'm old now. I want to give up my position. I want to give up for my younger generation. But it is not easy. One does not do it unless one is forced by time factor, by disease, time factor, old age, or when somebody is thrown out of the post. One does not go out. Everybody wants to hold back. But here Yudhishthira Maharaj is so qualified, you know, he just leaves, establishes Parikshit Maharaj as the king and walks out. But to do all this thing, Krishna had to work 84 years of hard work. You know, very interesting. You know, it was a revelation few days back. Otherwise we think, you know, Krishna comes to this material world, jumps around, plays with gopis and makes also Yudhishthira Maharaj king and he goes back to the spiritual world. It's not so easy. When he came to Hastinapur, can you imagine when he comes to Hastinapur as a peacemaker? You know, we had this discussion in our school with the children. Does Krishna fail? They got shocked. You know, how can Krishna fail? Krishna doesn't fail. But Krishna does fail. Many times he does fail. Why? Because Prabhupada writes in one purport in the Gita, unless the living entity cooperates with the Lord, things cannot become successful. When the Lord comes to the material world, you know, the living entity has to cooperate with Krishna. Unless the living entity takes to Krishna consciousness, then there is no question of Krishna forcing us to take to Krishna consciousness. And unless we take to Krishna consciousness, there is no happiness, there is no pleasure, there is no proper governance also. So when Krishna came as a peacemaker in Hastinapur, you know, the entire sages, all the sages came there. And Vidura told the Lord, my dear Lord, there is no point in speaking to Dhritarashtra, Duryodhana, they are not going to listen to you. Krishna said, I need to try my best. He said, if I try my best, even though I fail, you get credit for trying for good thing. See, Krishna is acting as karmaniyavadikaraste maphalechu kadachan. I need to perform my duty so that nobody should blame me that I did not put my efforts. And what a talk he gave. In fact, when he came there, this is Vidur, you know, Vidur is very nice. When he came to sit on the throne, Vidur said, wait a minute. Vidur stopped Krishna and he went around, you know, pressing the asana if there is no bomb kept in the asana. Mahabharata explains that. He looked around to see that, you know, this Duryodhan, Shakuni, Karna and Dushyasan have not hidden some weapons to kill Krishna. They can't kill Krishna, but that is the mood of a devotee. And he checked. After checking, Krishna sat there and he spoke so beautifully. Everybody heard, Dhritarashtra heard, Gandhari heard, Bhishma heard, Dronacharya heard, everyone heard about the consequences of the war. He said, just give them 5 villages. And what does Duryodhan say? Duryodhan say, 5 villages? Forget, even I would not give a space which is as much as they're on the head of the needle. Arrogantly said that to Krishna. And nobody stopped it. Everybody was, you know, mute spectators. Bhishma, Drona, Dhritarashtra. Again, Dhritarashtra said, I can't do anything. It's all the will of God. He was the biggest criminal. No? He was not weak, he was wicked. And then Krishna said, you have to face the consequences. And they tried to capture Krishna also. Can you imagine? You come as an ambassador, as a messenger, they wanted to capture Krishna, all of these 4 people. Of course, they couldn't capture Krishna. And Krishna comes back. And he said, the peace efforts are failed. Krishna genuinely wanted to establish peace. But they genuinely didn't want to establish peace. Like Ramayana explains, there was a competition between Ram and Ravan. Ram said, I want to save you, I want to save you. And Ravan is saying, I want to die, I want to die. Ultimately, Ram lost the battle. Why? Because Ravan died. His desires were fulfilled. Ram's desires were not fulfilled. So, living entity has to cooperate. So, when Krishna came, and then what happens? Right on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, the very person whom he has depended so much. Can you imagine? Krishna is depending on Arjun so much. Arjun has said, I am not going to fight. He is arguing with Krishna. He keeps his bow and arrow down. Just imagine, you have prepared one of your students very nicely to, you know, fight the wrestling match in the Olympics. And then he says, I am not going to fight. All your efforts. But here Arjun says, I am not going to fight. He made a decision that I am not going to fight. And then he changed the decision fortunately. If he had already decided, I am not going to fight, and he had not asked the further questions, my dear Lord, I am confused about my duty. Krishna had to find somebody else. Maybe Shikhandi had to find. If Arjuna was not willing. But Arjuna changed his mind. He said, my dear Lord, I am confused. And with great patience, again Krishna did not create a miracle. Not that he changed Arjuna's mind by changing something within his mind. He took an effort to speak Bhagavad Gita with great intensity. And Arjuna back and forth, asking question to Krishna. You know, almost till the end. At the end, Arjuna is still confused. Therefore, Sarvadharman Paritya verse is spoken. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur explains, after speaking all that, Arjuna was still confused. Krishna said, don't worry. My dear Arjun, don't worry. Forget this karma yoga. Forget this nishkama karma yoga. Forget this level, that level, third level, fourth level, 12th chapter. He said, forget all about these things. He said, just surrender unto me. Don't cry now. Arjuna was crying actually because he was more confused. He said, don't cry now, just surrender unto me. I will take care of everything. You become an instrument which is not working. But become an instrument. Become an instrument, I will take care of you. So Krishna made Arjuna. Sharanagati means what? Sharanagati means giving complete shelter to Arjuna. And then Arjuna worked for Krishna. And then again, while fighting on behalf of Krishna also, many times when you would see Bhishma. No, I'll conclude within 5-10 minutes. So Arjuna had to fight Bhishma. He was not fighting Bhishma very strongly. Still his mind was thinking, Bhishma is my grandfather. That's what happens to normal people when they see, you know, their own relatives being a criminal and you are a police officer. You don't come for the duty only. Because you don't have the guts to catch. In the material world, unfortunately, our decisions are based upon our attachment to our friends, relatives, family members. We cannot take decision based upon truth. We take decision based upon our mundane attachments. We always see that if there is two children are fighting, the mother, most of the time, very rare mothers will take side of justice. Why? Because she is a mother. What do you expect? She will only take the side of her baby. You know, it is but natural. If there is a friend, we will take the side of the friend only. So we are human. So Arjuna was going through this situation. You know, Krishna told him the very first chapter, hey, look, I killed my uncle also. I killed my mama. So you can kill your grandfather also if there is a need. Not that we are interested in killing, but because they are criminals, we may have to do it. So on the end of the 9th day when Arjuna came down to Bhishma Dev along with Yudhishthir. No, Yudhishthir Maharaj, he told Bhishma Dev, my dear grandfather, please bless us that we can go back to forest again. He said, why? He said, what are you doing? You know, you are not allowing us to win only. Give us the secret how to kill you. Then to ask, Krishna told him to ask. And then Bhishma Dev said, okay, this is the secret. If you want to kill me, he said, anyone who has a flag which is inauspicious, Anyone who is the only son of his parents, anyone who is a woman, anyone who has the name which is resembling woman, anyone who was a woman in his last lifetime, you bring them in the front, I will not fight. Then I will lose the battle. Like Shikhandi, he just gives that example also. And when next morning, Arjuna's mind is still weak. And before that, twice it happened. Krishna had to rush, wanting to kill Bhishma Dev. And Arjuna promised, no, I will kill, don't worry, I will do, you don't break your promise. He said, I have to break your promise if you act like this. Because I need to protect you. Twice Arjuna became weak-hearted. You know, natural. So when Arjuna asked this question, you know, this is one very beautiful commentator explains. He told, my dear Lord, how can I kill my grandfather? He is my grandfather. I only remember what he did for me in my childhood. He fed me. Sometime I would spoil his beard also, but he would not mind. Sometime I would spoil his white. You know, Bhishmida means personification of purity. From toe to, you know, top to bottom. Complete purity. Somebody is very attached to wearing clean clothes. They are afraid to carry children. Because they can do anything and everything. So here Bhishmadev was willing to forgive Arjun many times. He said, how can I do it? Then the example is given. Krishna told Arjun, he said, my dear Arjun, just like there is an artist, he paints the picture. When he paints the picture, he doesn't go based upon what color he likes. I like yellow, I like blue, I like saffron. But you can't go on what is your liking. You have to paint the picture, whatever the picture requires the paint. He said, don't paint the picture of your grandfather only what you like. Unfortunately, you have to paint the exact picture of your grandfather. Very, very cruel and very painful. He said, paint the picture of your grandfather, which is the real picture. Not only what you like. He said, your grandfather is party to the aggressors. No, he is party to the Kauravas. He is party when Draupadi was disrobed. So is your grandfather or is he party to aggressor? You have to understand very clear picture. He said, he's my devotee, he's my greatest of the devotees. But here I have to establish dharma, therefore you have to paint a real picture also. So Arjuna had to, you know, struggle to fight. Prabhupada explained, one time he called two of his servants in the middle of the night. And he showed the picture. You see this picture? It was a picture of Arjuna fighting on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. And he said, it is not easy to be devotee of Krishna. One may have to deal with one's own grandfather also. As a Kshatriya, one may have to go deal with the grandfather. He said, go and sleep now. He just called them for that and sent them back. So Arjuna, you can imagine what kind of love Arjuna had for his grandfather. Nowadays they will kill their grandfather. They will send them to old age home. No. But here Arjuna had real love for his grandfather. Dronacharya, what kind of love he had? You know, when Dronacharya and Arjuna would meet even from a distance, you know, they would cry tears of gratitude. When Dronacharya saw Arjuna from a distance after 12, 13 years, he was crying tears by seeing in a distance that Arjuna is dressed like, not dressed, he had become eunuch. It was not that Arjuna was dressed like that, he had become eunuch based on the curse of Urvashi. Actually his body had changed. No, he had changed. So still Dronacharya could recognize. And what Arjuna did? Arjuna shot an arrow before fighting. He shot an arrow at the feet of his master and one close to his ears. One to seek permission and one to seek his blessings. Just see, and what Dronacharya did for Arjun. And again, he was a neutral party also during Draupadi's disrobing, gambling match. But still there was a great affection for his master. And Arjun had to deal with that. And Krishna had to convince. And imagine one of the story of how Krishna could never reveal the Pandavas that Karna was their brother. Again, otherwise you have to deal with another problem. If they are so affectionate to grandfather, affectionate to their friends, and actually it happened. When Kunti told Yudhishthir, they are performing last rites of all the dead soldiers, like during our partition time. Like Prabhupada explains, dead bodies are brought together and nobody was giving final rites, just in wholesale they were being burnt. Just imagine Kurukshetra, according to Prabhupada, 64 crore people died. And for 18 days, the bodies were lying. The description is there, Mahabharata. Blood was flowing like a river, and the broken wheel of the chariot, and there were heads rolling, the hands were rolling, with, their hands being covered with bracelets. All this thing description is there, and the vultures, jackals were moving about, and all the bodies had to be cremated, wholesale. Only those who were connected, and some members survived, their bodies being cremated by the relatives. When it came to the turn of Karna, Kunti says, Yudhishthira, you have to do it. Everybody was shocked. He said, why? Why of Karna, of all the person? He was the most meanest on the side of the Kurus. Why? Because his language. One of the harshest person in his speech. He would condemn his guru, Dronacharya. He would condemn Bhishma. He would condemn the Pandavas. He condemned everybody. He condemned his own chariot driver also. One of the greatest fiasco of the Mahabharata battle is Karna the Rati and Shala is Sarthi. More than fighting the other party, they are fighting with each other. All the worst kind of bad words, if you read Mahabharata, kind of bad words they are giving with each other. Because they were all given false ego, that Shalya was told that you are like Krishna. And Karna was told that you are like Arjun. But Arjun is Arjun and Krishna is Krishna. Karna cannot become Arjun and Shalya cannot become Krishna. Because there was such a coordination between Krishna and Arjun. And there was no coordination. So when this news was relayed to the Pandavas, Yudhishthira Maharaj, Arjun, Bhima, they were all shocked. They asked Krishna, why you did not tell us? Then Krishna had to speak Nava Bhagavatam for Arjun. Or Bhagavad Gita for Arjun. Just see how much trouble the Lord had to take. For what? So that there is a proper governance. Only when there is proper governance, then our economic condition, our proper sense gratification, which is not against dharma, and then the facilities to practice devotional service can be established. Otherwise it is not possible. Therefore in conclusion, Prabhupada explains that this Krishna consciousness movement is not different from the incarnation of the Lord. It is not different. Why it is not different? Because he explains in that purport wherein Shukadeva Goswami explained why Krishna came here. He says, by teaching people according to their occupation in Varnashram Dharma, whatever occupations they have, we should not make Krishna less available for people by quoting scripture and making people more and more disqualified. No, bhakti and devotional service is not there to make people fall. No, if we talk about, sometimes it happens, those who are not with people, they quote the previous acharyas, this is what, and this is how it was made. This is how it was made in our time. Now you are compromising. Times do change. Applications, as time changes, it changes. So therefore, bhakti is not to minimize people taking to Krishna consciousness. Our approach should be in such a way that it maximizes people's coming to Krishna consciousness. So Krishna appeared. He could have stayed in the spiritual world to minimize those who can go back to Godhead. Their number would be very less if he would not come. But by coming to this material world, yes, certainly some opposed, but because of that, as Prabhupada writes in the purport, more and more people got benefit. Therefore, Krishna consciousness movement means becoming liberal. Not liberal in regards to our own practice, but in regards to liberally patience, liberally compassionate. No, liberally seeing a potential in every living entity. You know, that therefore Prabhupada explains every profession in Varnashram Dharma he speaks. No profession is bad for practicing devotional service. And people have to do all kinds of occupation. All kinds of occupation. What we have to do? We have to add little Krishna there. We have to add little Krishna there. Little Krishna. One can be a teacher. One can be a warrior. One can be a politician also. In fact, we need more politicians. You know, we don't need politics in our society, but we need more politicians who understands Krishna. Unfortunately, this country, you know, very strange. Somebody sent me an article about some of the great intellectuals of India, how they defy Krishna. You know, they will defy Krishna, they will defy Ram, they will defy everything which is connected to Vedic religion, but they have no power to defy Muhammad or Jesus. You will never find any Hindu intellectual defying Jesus or Muhammad. Why? Because they are hypocrites. In parliament, here, there, everywhere, you know, all these intellectuals, as we are discussing Krishna's appearance, there are hundreds of such intellectuals. You know, especially the English media, very organized way, what they are doing, they are trying to defy Krishna's Gita, you know, Krishna's personality, you know, Krishna's history, very consciously, very organized way, through our education system, through our political system, through our agriculture system. You know, every system, whatever system they get, they are trying to defy. They want to remove Krishna, they want to remove Ram, they want to remove our scriptures. If you see very carefully, analyze. Therefore, how much we need someone who understands Krishna consciousness, understands Gita, understands Bhagavatam. Therefore, Prabhupada explained in one lecture many years back, you know, which I was listening to, he says that Gita and Bhagavat is more required for kings and politicians than the ordinary people. Because if there is no proper understanding, the country will go to the dogs. And if this very country, which is the land of Dharma, which Lord Chaitanya says, that one has to fulfill, and the governance is made in such a way that you have no facilities to practice any spiritual life. They don't want you to practice spiritual life. They don't want you to have any connection with spirituality. Therefore, always they have arranged in such a way that our mind is distracted. Olympics. What we have to do with Olympics? Distraction. You know, they will talk how India did not get gold medal. We need to discuss about, you know, somebody sent a letter. You know, therefore, you know, our celebration has to be, why sober? You know, in Vrindavan, you know, our so many ladies come there to end their life living in Vrindavan, performing devotional service. It's a sad story to hear. All these ladies, they come from Bengal and other parts of India. And when they die, there is no one to cremate their bodies, and their bodies are cut into pieces and put in the gunny bag and discarded elsewhere. They don't even get the final rites, which every human deserves according to our Vedic system. They don't get that also. And even in Vrindavan, unfortunately, where Krishna came, there also we need great governance. Therefore, Bhaktivinoda Thakur put himself there for some time. Krishna performed sweet pastime, but there are gruesome activities that are happening. You know, there are land mafia, there is so much of, you know, black money being circulated, you know, in the name of Krishna only. Right. So therefore, on this occasion, we have to understand that we have to expand the concept of what Krishna consciousness is. Krishna consciousness is not only coming to the temple. Krishna consciousness is not only dressing the deities. Krishna consciousness is not only, you know, directly doing devotional service. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam. How many people get to do that 24 hours? In fact, even once a week also. And within the day, how many hours? Very less. But if you don't expand Krishna consciousness, that let me add Krishna here also. Let me add Krishna here also. Let me add Krishna here also. Let me add Krishna also here also. And that was what Prabhupada wanted to do. He did not minimize the facility of practicing devotional service to limited sphere. He expanded. You know, he expanded to such an extent. In the beginning, he told Americans that you experience Krishna in the taste of wine. Can you imagine that? You know, wine and bhakti goes ill together. But they know, they only knew wine, no water also. So how do you convince them about Krishna? He said, experience taste in the wine. That is also Krishna. So therefore, you know, if Krishna has to establish proper governance, as he did during Yudhishthira Maharaj's time, and we can pray to the Lord and his pure devotees like Prabhupada, that Krishna, let there be proper governance, which is very important, very much required. Therefore, Krishna comes to this material world. And how is it possible that we take to Krishna consciousness seriously, perform our sadhana properly, and wherever you see whatever kind of people are, try to give Krishna to them as they need Krishna. I may need Krishna differently. Somebody may need Krishna differently. Other person may need Krishna differently. You know, someone else may need Krishna differently. If you can give Krishna in his different features, in his different activities, then people will take to Krishna consciousness more dynamically. Otherwise, we will become criminals of making Krishna consciousness very stereotyped. And that's what happens. As the disappearance of Acharya, the followers become stereotyped and are very rigid in their understanding and feel that my understanding is what means I am loyal to Krishna consciousness. But if my loyalty is stopping many people from coming to Krishna consciousness, then what is that? So therefore, those who are being very dynamic but at the same time being very rigid in their own sadhana, we should work with them, assist them, and take to Krishna consciousness another level. And that is the best way to celebrate Krishna Janmastami. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Now, His Grace Braj Bihari Prabhu will speak about Kaliya. You know, I'll just conclude with this, that our Pejar Swami, from Udupi, he said, Kaliya is like a modern industry, which is creating limitless pollution. And Jamuna is polluted because of that. You know, there is a lot of discussion is going on to save Jamuna. You know, devotees are requested to write petition, you know, about saving Jamuna. If you go, that article is for Jamuna saving only. They said, actually, Jamuna water doesn't come to Vrindavan only. Jamuna water is diverted to some other place. What comes to Vrindavan is all sewage water. Unfortunately. Doesn't come. Upwards, somewhere in Himalayas only, somewhere it is converted, diverted somewhere else. And what comes to Vrindavan is not the Jamuna water. No, that is the birthright of Vrindavan to get Jamuna water. But they are not getting. And why this all happened? It all happened because of this, you know, greedy, you know, polluting, you know, industries which caused. And he was mentioning that Kaliya represents that. You know, he represents that thing, and therefore Jamuna water was contaminated. So let us hear from Braj Bihari Prabhu the beautiful pastimes of Krishna chastising Kaliya. Jai Srila Prabhupada ki. Krishna Chandra Bhagavan ki.